Welcome back to the podcast, everybody. Welcome to the latest episode of Tax Tech and Other Stuff, the podcast from Tax Systems. I am continually the host of this. My name's Russell. I have been with Tax Systems about 4 years now and very, very pleased to introduce our guest for the day. Our guest is Rob Ogilvie. Some people will know him as the head of tax development. Some will know him as our tax guru and other similar words or phrases. So, Rob, firstly, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you, Russell. Thank you for having me.
Excellent. And just tell us a little bit about yourself. Who are you? What do you do?
I'm Robin Ogilvie, officially Robin. Most people call me Rob. So work-wise, as you said, I lead the tax development team here at Tax Systems. So as some listeners may know, our company provides software that people use to fill in various types of tax return, usually corporate returns of some sort. And the team that I work in is responsible for making sure that the tax logic that sits behind those products is all kept up to date and is working correctly. Which is a never-ending challenge, but an interesting one as well. So my background is that, way back when I was at university, I was a scientist originally. So I studied physics and maths. And as part of that, I started to learn about logic and coding through mathematical modeling and graph plots and that kind of thing, using Fortran and the like, really old programming languages. But then my dad, my uncle, and my sister were all either accountants or tax accountants. So I had that kind of gene that I couldn't get away from. So I always had that in my mind as kind of a good career path and something that I might be interested in. So when I left university, I kind of managed to combine those two and sort of found myself working in tax software, and I've been working in the industry since. So passed my tax exams some 15 years ago now. And from a tax perspective, I suppose I'm a corporation tax specialist, but over the years I've worked on various areas, so comfortable around, you know, the likes of income tax, VAT, partnerships, that kind of stuff, although I still avoid inheritance tax as much as possible.
That's the avoiding of the technical part of inheritance tax rather than avoiding paying inheritance tax.
Exactly, yes, yeah, good clarification, absolutely. So that's kind of my history, and then,
Awesome. Good to hear. I'm actually, I'm third generation ACA. Not too many people know that. My dad and my granddad both paid up members of the profession for better or for worse. So with our nearly two-year-old, I continually joke when she's counting up to 10 that she's going to be the fourth generation, poor girl.
Absolutely.
But such is life. You talk about the tax development team, and one of the things that kind of astounded me a little bit when I joined the business nearly 4 years ago was that, you know, we have that team in-house called Tax Dev, and, you know, it's a number of people, but it feels like a really, really unique team. Obviously, we are a relatively unique kind of business, but, you know, tell us a bit about that team. What does a typical day or week in Tax Dev world look like?
Yeah, it's a... I think it's a really interesting role, and so it's sort of kept me engaged for many, many years. And we've got a couple of people in the team who've been there longer than me, so it kind of shows that it can kind of hook you in. It is varied. So as I referred to, so our primary responsibility is staying on top of legislation. So we have to be aware of the changes. So we're kind of following news articles, reading tax magazines, you know, attending the odd webinar, that kind of thing, all trying to see what's coming up. And that goes into our planning of what we need to be working on, feeding a little bit into, you know, the longer term strategy of our business, which kind of has that interest in terms of where we want to be going tax wise. And also speaking with our customers, acting a little bit like product managers to kind of see where they are, what they're working on, what's coming up for them, all feeding into what we want to be working on developing. We develop the changes ourselves. So I kind of generally describe us as tax accountants who pretend to be software engineers. So where you're picking up a particular developer item, you'll be diving into, you know, that part of the legislation in real detail, sort of as a tax accountant, understanding what it means, you know, where that sits within the broader taxes acts, working out what, you know, it's written text, so what that means in terms of a maths calculation, if you put in some profits or losses or whatever, what, how that needs to flow through, and doing that kind of conversion in your mind as to what that would look like in our software. And so there's a really large degree of judgment and experience that's needed there to kind of understand how all these things kind of fit together. And collaboration there as well. So, you know, often there'll be a little sticking point that you're not quite sure of, you know, something doesn't quite make sense. So you're collaborating with your team members or even third parties like HMRC. So it's good working together kind of process. And then once you understand the change, you have to actually dive into the code. So we work in a coding environment as well. And for our corporation tax product, AlphaTax, we've got a product that we use, a coding environment, which has got about 180,000 calculations and 2,000 statements or sheets, if you like, that are users see and interact with. So there's quite a large body of code there you're trying to work with, and sort of working out where your changes slot in that and how you want to introduce what you want to introduce without breaking anything as you leave is always a fun challenge. And that feeds into a bit of kind of design and UI and UX work as well. So we're kind of, as well as actually writing the mass calculations, we're kind of showing what it's going to look like, what the inputs are, what the wording is, just deciding what the disclosure looks like that's going to go to HMRC. So thinking a little bit about user experience as well. Whenever you're coding, there's always kind of a trade-off between various different things. So one of them, for example, is, you know, simplicity versus readability. So we'll be thinking about, you know, you can write a, you know, a really clever line of code to do something, you know, in a really fewest number of characters possible. But the problem is the next person then can't read it or understand it or change it. So it can be better sometimes to intentionally make something a bit longer in our code so it's easier to look after going forward. And similarly, another trade-off is about how much content you provide for users versus how much it's going to cost us to look after. So there's a saying that the best code is no code at all, because for every line that you write, it's more to look after, more that can possibly go wrong. And, you know, we want to kind of keep things as streamlined as possible. So you're kind of thinking, you know, you only want to add stuff that's really necessary. So really interesting, all of that side of it. Because the work that we do, the coding is so specialist, we also are the only people that can test it properly. So, you know, as well in our role, we're testing something someone else has written, and that has its own layer of intrigue and challenges. You know, you're trying to put yourself in the shoes of a user, trying to think, would it make sense? You're doing that deep analysis of the legislation as well, trying to second pair of eyes to make sure that what the developer did you think is correct. And trying to think of all those little edge cases, you know, often it's the, a bit like the 80-20 rule. So, you know, you get most of it working quite straightforwardly, and then it's all the little bits around the edges that you're working on, trying to work out how you can get it all working. So that kind of summarizes our development. And then, you know, there's always other bits going on as well. So we work with our professional services team in our business, who are the ones who kind of speak to customers where they've got problems. We'll kind of help them quite closely, trying to sort of smooth off issues and everything. We produce written documentation as well. So we kind of pretend to be technical authors as well. We write our help and release notes and that kind of stuff. So explaining what we've been doing, and then various other projects that are going on in the business, you know, so getting involved with even our own company tax returns. That's one of the things that I have to do, is make sure they get done correctly. So it's all a fascinating insight using our own software in practice.
Yeah, that must be, it must feel a bit weird kind of doing your own tax returns and your own software.
It does. But, it's really insightful though, but it's really good.
Nice. No, I mean, that role sounds varied and quite sort of mind-boggling, and I certainly, from some of the little sort of edge case snippets that I've seen, and I'm, you know, only around the edges, it's a pretty impressive task. And I guess, you know, you've been in the role for a good while now and seen some I guess some big changes come and go. What are some of the things though, some of the big changes that you've seen over your time that's, you know, had you really sitting down going, oh my god, how are we going to deal with this, what's happened there?
As I referred to, been working in it a long time, it continues to be fascinating how the industry sort of evolves, both in terms of tax and also, you know, the use of technology as well. So, you know, thinking back, I suppose, you know, mandatory e-filing was the first big one that I kind of saw, which came in about 2011. So that was kind of it had been optional before that. So some companies were already taking advantage of that, but it becoming mandatory was kind of a big shift for us and sort of another, well, signaling the direction of travel in terms of, you know, tax becoming intertwined with technology, and also, you know, another layer of value that we could provide, because there was this further compliance leg that our customers had to get over, and something that we could offer, you know, having this XBRL tagging introduced into the computation was kind of a big challenge just for us. So that was quite a cool thing to look into. And while I say it was mandatory, there were even then and even now, there are exemptions for digitally excluded. So that was kind of interesting and kind of hinted at some of the challenges that HMRC are still facing in terms of trying to, you know, when they have these technological initiatives, you know, they have to bring everyone on the journey. And, you know, some people have different stages of adoption. So that was kind of a really interesting one. Tax-wise, I'd have to point to 2017 as well, which happened to be the first time I took over as head of the team, first year.
Nice.
And that was the year where, for corporation tax, they introduced the carry forward loss restriction and the interest restriction in the same Finance Act. So two huge pieces of work for us that we spent many months on. So really interesting and, you know, engaging work, and it was quite a year for us. And at that time, you know, some of you may remember that we had a change of government, because that was shortly after the Brexit vote. And so we kind of had Theresa May coming in, and we kind of had legislation being included in the bill and then removed. So there was lots of head scratching as to whether this was going to be introduced or not, after we'd spent many months ripping up our losses calculations. So that was all good fun at the time. And one of those ones that hopefully for our customers in the end, we kind of, you know, for certain field of the loss restriction, you know, our software does the legwork for us. So it was all fun and games for us. But, you know, that's the role that we have in sort of, you know, taking care of it for our customers. And on that one, there's, you know, there's still, even today, kind of tax planning considerations you have for those, you know, that there's a 50% restriction on the use of losses. So there's still things you can think about even now. So that was the next one. And then VAT, entity for VAT came along in, I think it was about 2019 in the end when it got introduced. So that was another big one for our business and for me personally in my role. So we didn't have a VAT product before that. But obviously there was a, you know, this big disruptive event in the marketplace in terms of this new e-filing, well, new submission mechanism, I should say, coming in. And so we decided to take the leap at that time and sort of jump in and create a new product there. So loads of great learning. I think that was our first cloud-based product at the time. So our first proper cloud product. So, you know, loads of good stuff, getting to grips with what that entailed. And I remember going through getting examples of customer spreadsheets that they had been using and kind of just scratching your head over what was going on and how that would be converted into software. So it was all good fun and good learning. And that's, you know, an established product for us now. So it's, you know, it's a good thing to have gone through.
Yeah, I've seen a few of those spreadsheets in my time. They're interesting, I think, is certainly a word that I would use.
Yeah. And the last one I have to mention more recently is, you know, I've got to mention generative AI. And I know this is a passion of yours, Russell, but, you know, of course, a huge topic and, you know, a disruptor in almost every industry, but certainly in tax. You know, we're seeing various tools coming to the market. So things that can do tax analysis for you. You know, we've got tax legislation, you know, smart search engines, that kind of thing coming out. We've got Gen AI powered bots that will read documents and fill in HMRC web pages for you. And as you know, Russell, so our business has taken the leap and we launched AlphaMap just last month. So a new product that Wizzy accounts data mapping and does, you know, the legwork for you. So hopefully really exciting to see what, you know, software developers can produce with those technologies and you know, hopefully produce something that solves a problem for our customers and, you know, raises standards.
And that's it, isn't it? And I think I'm impressed we've managed to get this far through without mentioning Gen AI, so we've done well. And I didn't even bring it up this time, which is rare. But I think it's been interesting because this, you know, just this week actually I've been starting to prepare. I've got a few conferences in the next couple of months. It's kind of conference season is kind of April, May time. And started to prepare and think about some of the materials. And one of the talks I'm doing is just simply titled The Death of the Tax Return? You know, is the tax return going to go away because we've got these, you know, generative AI powered things that are just going to be able to, you know, take all this legislation and bring it through? And I think one of the visuals I'm starting to work on, which I think is really neat, is that, you know, you've got legislation. You've got, I think, somebody referenced in 2016, 21,000 pages of UK CT logic, which is something like 10 times the length of the Bible. Then you've got over 2,000 kind of case law examples, and you've got all these things. Now, we know generative AI does a great job with analyzing text, so that's kind of part of the problem. But the part of the problem it doesn't necessarily cater so well for are those kind of bits of inbuilt knowledge in people's heads, in kind of the judgments that they make in the kind of context of a particular business. You know, you could have two businesses with identical numbers, but because they're doing quite different things, might be treating things in a totally different way. And all of that kind of nuance that just doesn't really sit that well, at least not yet, in a any kind of central model. So I think what, you know, the point that I'm at least trying to get to in my head is, look, you know, it can do some parts of this process very well, but it certainly cannot, you know, just be like, oh yeah, well, here's the corporation tax return for this company based on some inputs that we give it. That's not really the way that we're going with this. Would you agree with that? Is that what's in your head when you think about Gen AI and tax?
Yeah, I'd certainly agree. I do see there's still going to be a role for the tax professional who's kind of the expert. And I kind of view it a little bit like the introduction of, you know, the calculator, isn't it? It's a tool and it, you know, it can solve a problem for you. It can speed something up. But, you know, it always needs, in my view, kind of that human logic, that human brain finishing it off. And, you know, it can take you so far, but then there's always going to be a role for the tax professional to have that understanding, as you say, about the customer, about the particular industry and about the particular circumstances for any particular companies. Yeah, it's exciting and it can certainly solve some challenges. But
one of the images I might try and bring back is there's a good picture when they first brought in calculators. There was teachers that protested and said that calculators were sort of
really
horrendous. How could you possibly have these things? Because, you know, people needed to learn how to add up. And there's some good I think Daily Mail headlines around the protests around that. So I might whip those back out because it's another good reminder that, again, as you say, these things are tools. They're not just going to magically solve everything, but they are certainly tools that are useful. And if we started banning calculators, we'd all be in a spot of bother. So moving on, I guess you've covered what you've kind of covered so far and what's happened going backwards. What's the next kind of 12 months or so? What does that look like in your head? Do you know what's coming up and what your team will be working on or
We have a rough idea. So it's always evolving, as we refer to. It's always changing. But as I mentioned, so looking after the core corporation tax rules and alpha tax is our main focus. So we've just this last few weeks, we've sort of finished off what will become our April release. So that always has the latest tax returns and the latest e-filing schemas and the latest finance act. So we're kind of up to date there, which is always nice. So we'll start thinking ahead to, getting that release packaged up and delivered to customers in April. And then we'll look ahead to a second release of this year. So where we get up to date with legislation, you know, we then get a chance to look at more enhancement type mm-hmm. stuff, which is always fun to try and do something new. So we can think about that in the second half of the year. And while I say we're up to date with legislation, you know, it's going to be an interesting year because we just had a budget last week. Yep. And I think actually just this morning, a bill was published following that up. So we'll take a look at that. And we also think, of course, there's going to be a general election later this year. So it was being proposed as in November, we think. But then I have seen, you know, there was a Sky News article yesterday talking about the possibility of a snap election. Mm. So we'll follow that closely. And again, no predictor, but it is looking highly likely we'll see a change in government. So we'll have to plan accordingly. And whenever that happens, whenever there's a general election, the legislative timetable changes. So, you know, normally we get acts becoming acts in the April, in the springtime. But that will all go out the window and we'll get new legislation coming through more quickly. So we'll be keeping an eye out on that, of course. Mm. On other projects, our business is continuing to work on a cloud version of our corporation yep. tax product. So my team kind of has a role to play there. We've kind of been helping quite a lot with that project in terms of elicitation, so kind of explaining what the current product does and what needs to be replicated and how. Mm-hmm. And then we're kind of, I refer to the fact that we do testing earlier. So we're kind of in a good place as people who kind of understand what the product is supposed to do yep. and can test what it's doing. And also point out those little areas where it can perhaps be made better. So where the cloud product can go above and beyond what the current one does. And the group module at the moment is something we're looking at. So spending a bit of time on that area.
Nice. Busy.
Busy. Well, I hadn't finished.
Keep going. I like it.
well, Pillar 2 is another one, which again, I know you know about. So global minimum 15% rate of corporation tax. So my team spent a few months at the end of last year putting together a model for that, a calculation mm-hmm. engine to kind of show what we could do. And we're kind of busy showing that to customers at the moment, trying to get them excited, trying to, you know, get them on board. Having done the sort of the main calculation, we're kind of looking at the other two ends of that process. So the starting point being data. Yeah. And this kind of seems to be the big challenge with Pillar 2. You know, people working out what the inputs their calculation are, where they're going to get it from their ERP systems, etc., and how we can sort of get that into our products automatically. Mm-hmm. So looking at that. And then on the other side, reporting. So lots of question marks at the moment over what reporting is going to look like. You know, we're having conversations with for example HMRC and the Irish Revenue to kind of see what their plans are and where we'd need to yep. go. It's still a while off, but something else we need to think about. UAE corporation tax is another one. Yep. So we're being introduced for the first time for accounting periods beginning in June, I think, last year. So we've been taking a look at that, thinking about whether there's a business case for our company to go and produce some software over there to produce these returns. And again, my team spent a little bit of time putting together a bit of a model about what that would look like. So that was quite good fun to put together.
Awesome.
And then another one, I suppose, it's a little bit on the back burner, but Companies House reform. So there was a piece of legislation last year which gave Companies House a raft of new powers, primarily aimed at you know, the register for directors and sort of tightening up that register in terms of who's listed. But it also they announced that they were intending to introduce XBRL accounts yep. filings at Companies House, which kind of, we have a product that does that called AlphaMap. And so that kind of has an effect on that. And again, the Gen AI topic comes up there as to whether yeah. there's something, you know, we can do in that area to sort of improve that current offering. And it also ties into corporation tax because at the moment, HMRC asks for tagged accounts as part of the corporation tax submission. So, you know, whether that's going to stay the same or whether that can change or be made more efficient in some way is one of the things we're looking at.
Nice, that is busy. And just on, well, I guess the next thing that we spent quite a lot of time looking at a few years ago and then has kind of gone quiet and maybe will come back onto the radar soon is, of course, MTD for corporation tax. So I remember it wasn't too long after I joined in 2020 and then into 2021, we had the original consultation, and that consultation was potentially quite far reaching. You know, the impacts would have been pretty material. So we, you know, we obviously, as many other businesses did, responded to that consultation, and then it's gone rather quiet. And we know that MTD for income tax has been delayed, I think, a sum total of four or maybe five times at this point. But but hopefully we're going to get it in the now revised timeline. But I guess from your point of view, having obviously looked at the original consultations and ignoring timelines for a second, sort of what's your view around MTD for CT and how that all could work or should work or may not work? How does that all fit in your head?
The may not work is sticking in my head, but no, it's, I didn't put it in my previous answer. It's not something we're thinking about at the moment. I think, as you say, the last consultation was in 2021, was it?
Yeah, I think so.
And I think at the time they were saying, I think April 2026 at the earliest was the phrase that they were using at the time, but no publications that we've seen since then. And we do have conversations with HMRC, and it's not something they're talking about with us at the moment. So there don't seem to be any plans at the moment for this to be brought in anytime soon. As you referred to, they're still working through the income tax side. I think what we saw with entity for VAT, obviously HMRC can kind of come up with these strategies which all sound very good and ambitious, what they'd like to be able to achieve, and they do have benefits, you know, using technology, etc., but they encounter quite a lot of challenge when it comes to actually trying to put this into practice, particularly from taxpayers and also to an extent from software developers, you know, established players in the industries with their own processes, their own systems. And it can be a real challenge, you know, that these taxpayers come in all different shapes and sizes, you know, especially in corporation tax, you know, that you get the very smallest to some of the very largest companies in the world that you're thinking about. Mm. And trying to come up with a one size fits all approach is always going to be a super challenging thing to try to do. So spreadsheets were the famous example for VAT, where HMRC wanted to get rid of them, and they initially said that they were going to be banned. You weren't going to be allowed to use a spreadsheet. Yeah. Which was, you could see the sense in it, but they weren't able to get it over the line. And, you know, bridging remains valid even now. So, so with corporation tax, you know, I think most people would say there's obviously a role for increased use of technology, you know, software providers doing new and cleverer things to raise standards again, because MTD was all about the tax gap, wasn't it? It was all about, closing the tax gap, you know, people getting their tax right. So there's certainly a role there, and I certainly expect us to see progress and moving forward, but quite what MTD for CT looks like, I'm not so sure. So we shall have to wait and see. But
And I think, to be fair, from 2021, when the last consultation was, to I think the National Audit Office have said they wouldn't expect to see it anytime before 2030. So that's a that's a 9-year gap. And when we think about the amount of technological change we've had already between 21 and 24, when we've got another, you know, 5.5 years to go, it could be materially very different. Because in fact, the way that I would think about MTD for CT now is actually totally different to what I thought about it back in 2021. Because actually, you know, the way that they, I think it was 27 headings, not really tax headings, accounting headings, and actually the idea of mapping things, we've been through that journey ourselves in the last year or so. So it's a very interesting topic, but you're right, it doesn't appear to be on many people's radar. So we'll continue to ask questions, and when it does come back up, of course, we'll be all over it. But that's good. So I said a little bit earlier about conference season has just kicked off. I think there's a couple of conferences that are on this week and next, and as we get into April they kind of gear up, and ours is in May. I'm sure if anybody listening to the podcast is not aware of that, I would be surprised. We've been putting it out all over the airwaves and getting lots of people signing up, which is great. I remember one of the first things, and I think it was the first couple of weeks when I joined Tax Systems, someone said, oh yeah, we're thinking about the conferences, and we weren't quite sure because COVID was just coming in and all the rest of it, and it was all a bit of, you know, things were up in the air. But whenever anyone talked about the Tax Systems conference, it was all, well, you got to go to Rob's tax update. Everybody loves Rob's tax update. It's the big draw. Everybody wants to do it. So, of course, with our new relaunch conference that will be the first one we've done since COVID, you will be having a prominent spot on the agenda. Absolutely. Any kind of, you know, don't give too much away. But what can we expect? Have you started thinking about what we're going to hear from you this year? What's in your head on that one?
Well, I am scheduled to give a talk, but I haven't started writing it yet, so I can't give anything away even if I wanted to. And now feeling the pressure as well with that build up. But so I've got I think it's a half hour slot. Trying to give a tax update, and obviously when you're talking about tax, there's kind of a couple of things you always want to be conscious of. So one of them is that you always get a range of people in the room. So you're always trying to, you know, talk about what can be quite technical topics in a way that is quite light and understandable, whilst at the same time, you know, because we are specialists, trying to hint at the detail for those that do need to know it and, you know, what might want to come across it in practice and need to go and do some further reading. So I'm always trying to have that balance between not losing the people who aren't quite so tax specialist whilst also showing the detail to those that are. And also in my role, it's always interesting because companies have a year to file their return and legislation's introduced, in the year it's laid. What I'm working on now, most of our customers won't come across until next cycle, next year. So my latest updates are kind of future planning, if you like, useful there, but it's almost better to do a recap of what happened last year for our customers, because it's kind of, that's what they're working on at the moment. So, so with that in mind, full expensing for capital allowances is probably one that I'll mention. So, and probably the one that most people will come across for, most submissions have capital expenditure of some sort, or very common, reasonably straightforward to talk about. But the one thing there is that annual investment allowance is still hanging around. So I'll probably try to do a bit of a practical recap of the difference between the two and why you might use one or the other. There's new administrative requirements for R&D. Those were introduced middle of last year, so most people claiming may have already seen it, but from my point of view, I think it's kind of critical that you get it right, because it invalidates your claim if you don't fill in these returns that HMRC are asking for. So I think it bears repeating, going over again exactly what the position is, what the requirements are, and that also does lead into updates from this year's Finance Act, because R&D is being rewritten. So we currently have two schemes, and government have decided to simplify things by producing two schemes. So and we've got the Finance Act 2024 changes overlaying on top of 2023 changes as well. So there's a little bit to know about, what it looks like in 2023 versus what it looks like in 2024. So that's something that I'll probably touch on as well.
Nice.
And then several standalone taxes have been introduced. So the likes of residential property developer tax, we've had energy profits levy, and electricity generator levy. So all of which are quite niche and, not things that people come across very often, but, all worth mentioning for people having that awareness, but probably mention those in passing. And in a similar vein to that, also being reformed this year is creative industries. So, films and theatres and the like. So again, we've got a new tax credit scheme coming in for that. So again, not one that everyone comes across, but for those that do, it's, super important and critical to the, in practice, these tax credits are vital to the actual industries running. So an important one to mention, even though it's not applicable to so many people.
Nice. Cool. Well, the final question I have, very broad, giant, massive, blue sky thinking question, but, given that your involvement, and as you say, you are a UK CT specialist, if you could change one thing, or if you could do one thing, UK corporation tax, and this could be anything, this could be a particular thing, it could be more kind of holistic, anything you like, what would you change and why?
Goodness, it's quite a question that I'm not sure I'm impartial on this either, because I'm invested in the complexity in here. I think capital allowances was one of the areas that was kind of often mooted when you talk about corporation tax simplification. So we have this scheme that kind of gets rid of depreciation in the accounts and does a load more calculations to work out what your deduction should be, and we did have an office for tax simplification for a while. I think that got abolished last year, but that was one of the ones that they were talking about. But I think governments seem to be moving away from that. I think I just referred to full expensing being introduced. So, and that's now been made permanent. So it seems like we're, not going to go down that road. I think I also mentioned earlier, we did spend some time looking at UAE corporation tax. That was quite eye-opening in terms of reading legislation. They've produced a 50-something page PDF that represents their, their tax law. And obviously, you'd expect them to bolt on stuff on top of that, but it does kind of give you an insight into how simple legislation potentially can be. And I think they had an interest restriction that was less than one page, whereas we've got 100 sections in one of our acts to sort of cover the same thing. So it was kind of interesting just to see, whether the legislation that we see is really needed, or whether you can achieve it in a more simple way. From a selfish point of view as a developer, one of the things I've mentioned is the application dates, transitional provisions that we see when legislation is included. So it generally comes in from a point in time, and then government will typically say, oh, but we don't want to disadvantage people with certain year ends. So for periods straddling this date, we'll treat that it's just two notionally separate periods, which is always a pain for us and always produces horrible disclosure and gets people confused about what the situation is. And the other one is that wherever there's fictions in the legislation, so for the purposes of defining a calculation, we've actually seen this a couple of times just recently, because a small company's rate has now been reintroduced. for both patents and R&D, they both have this fiction that for the purposes of working out what your deduction is, you suppose that you didn't have the deduction and what the tax you paid would be. And then you go back and put it back in again. And I always find that's, you know, super confusing. And given the low level of the corporation tax rate, I always wonder whether it's really necessary to do that, whether you could just simplify that. So, so those are just some thoughts. And then, you know, the last one, I suppose, is just, you know, if you want to be really radical, you know, just thinking about, we still have basically the remnants of a scheduler system of taxation. So we used to have, you know, scheduled D1, D3 and all of this. And it's, we still have it in terms of trade and non-trade and, you know, management expenses, etc. But a lot of the reason for doing that has since gone away because, you know, it tend to be tied up with losses. But all of that was changed in 2017, where you could generally relieve all losses against each other, against general profits. So, you know, if you want to be really radical, and again, touching on UAE, that's exactly what they did. They just start from profit per the accounts, they don't stream it into schedules, and they just tax it from there and have some adjustments. So, you know, that would really rip up the tax computation.
That would be. Cool. Well, thank you very much for a very, very interesting chat. My head is about to explode, I think. So, yeah, thank you very much. And no doubt we will speak soon.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me, Russell. Cheers.
Cheers, everyone. Bye-bye.